quiero, al inicio de 2016, lo mejor que quiero, energía ver esto lleno, energía para seguir todo el año con lo doble. Bueno, como siempre, recordar algunas cositas antes de empezar. Hoy hay una cosita más, el aporte voluntario, pasa un tarrito, y esta vez tenemos tarro nuevo, es metálico y mucho más grande para que las monedas suenen y para que quepan más billetes. No, mentira, pasa el tarrito nuevo de hoy y detrás va el tarrito con las calcomanías para ustedes. El aporte voluntario es como que vive lo doy. También lo que hay que agregar hoy es que la charla es en inglés. Qué pena con los que nos enteraron. Si alguien tiene algún problema por la pérdida del tiempo con lo que hicimos todo y no estamos entendiendo mucho antes, la charla de hoy va en inglés. Así que, pues digo, los que no alcanzaron a enterarse, qué pena. Entonces, y lo último, como siempre, antes de dejarnos con Richard, esta semana, este año empezó muy rápido con todo y tenemos dos charlas de la última semana de enero. Este jueves seguimos y de ahí nos vamos derecho hasta noviembre. Este jueves tenemos el lanzamiento de la revista Sandía, una revista de literatura que se apoya en ilustración. Y viene Daniel Bustamante, Santiago Muñoz, Alejandro Montoya y Alejandro Cortés. También hay que agregar que ese día, después de que hace parte del lanzamiento, después de la charla, va a haber un pequeño concierto. Y bueno, sin más entonces, dejarlos con Richard Maguire, supongo que ya todos saben quién es, ilustrador, diseñador y muchas otras cosas, músico, etcétera, con 50 cosas que me inspiran en el diseño, la música, el cómic y el cine. Muchas gracias, Richard, muchas gracias también a todos los que hicieron esto posible, al festival, entre viñetas y el Fire. Un aplauso para Richard y los dejo con él.
show you a clip of this this guy. He was his name was Busby Berkeley, and he made these incredible dancing performances, these dance films in the 30s. And it's just to show you the influence of just that, that same thing of the camera looking down on something.
That's his most famous cover he did for The New Yorker.
just using, he tried many, many different styles simultaneously. And also, I just love the use of the way he uses crazy maps, like having this character going from March into April. And like this is great, having all those different styles simultaneously. It's just really adventurous. And it makes so much sense, it's like, you know, emotionally. This is a scene of Bleecker Street. This is really close to where I live right now. And one of the first covers that I got to do for the New Yorker was really influenced by this. I'll show you. This was the cover I did. It was for April Fool's Day. And so I made, what year was it? From 1995. So I made 95 things wrong with the cover. And I got lots of letters from people all telling me, like, finding more than I intended. And but I was really happy that I got to take the, in the logo, that I could reverse the letter in the logo. That was like very, you know, sacrilegious almost. Okay.
Yeah, I don't know. Something technical. Hello? Hello?
Hello? Hello? Hello? Is that better? I don't know. Okay, so then, I've worked for the New Yorker for at least, I don't know how many years now, 20 years probably. I've done a lot of covers. And for me, it was a real honor to work for the New Yorker because my hero, Saul Steinberg, was, you know, kind of a major artist for the magazine. That's a picture of Saul Steinberg. He made a lot of these masks. This was something, this is me wearing one of his masks. I got to visit his archive and see all his sketchbooks, and it was just the greatest thing for me to wear that mask. It was like big deal. So now I'm gonna get into the music stuff. When I was growing up, this song meant a real lot to me. It's Sly Stone's song called Thank You for Letting Me Be Myself Again. And I'm just gonna play a little clip of it. But also, what I really love about this particular record is the way that the title was written. This was the first edition of it. It says, Thank You for Letting Me Be Myself Again. And the second edition, it's written in this kind of phonetic language, which is like, thank you for letting me mice, elf, again. That's how it actually sounds, which I really love. But I just love the hook of this song. It's just, it gets me every time. And I think it was really, it really had a lot to do with my, a major musical influence.
Thank you.
not only the consciousness, but the fact that he's got like there's it's a mixed race band, and there's like four women in the band too. I think that's pretty great. And I think there was one brother and one sister in the band too. That's the family part of the slide, the family stone. I don't even know what I have next here, but Bowie, it's just like, and everybody in the room, you can feel it, like, oh, he was a major, influence. I mean, or not just, he was an adventurer, he did stuff that nobody else did. And I remember the day that I first heard this record, I was in high school, and a friend came in with it, and we went to the library, we put headphones on, and it just, like, blew my mind. I was in New York when I heard about him passing away, and I went by the building where he lives, because it wasn't so far from me, and it was just an amazing emotional scene to see all these flowers, and he had this penthouse, and it was built on top of the building, and it's like a castle up there. It's just amazing, really great. And I have one funny story about David Bowie. Like, my friend James Murphy, who plays with LCD Sound System, he told me, he sent me a text, and he said, "I just met David Bowie." This was like a year ago. And then he writes, "He has your book." And I was just like, and I was just about to get on a plane, and I was like, and it took me, I didn't get the full story until after, when I got back to New York, we had a dinner. And he told me that he met David Bowie in Electric Ladyland Studios. And, for him it was such a big deal, as it would be for any of us. But James told me his first record he ever bought was Fame. And when Bowie came in the studio, he said, "Oh, I haven't been in here since I recorded Fame back in 72, or whatever. Or whenever that was, maybe a little later. But then he opened a bag and he took out my book. And he said to James, "Have you seen this?" And James was like, "That's Richard's book." And he's, and Bowie said, "You know him?" And I was like, "Oh, that was my mom." So thank you, Bowie, for my memory. And for all the records. It was through listening to Bowie that I found out about Velvet Underground. And another just incredible band. And Lou Reed is like one of my all-time favorites. There they are, Velvet Underground. I met Lou once, and it was very intimidating, because my band was just starting, and we had to play a radio show with him. And it was gonna be a live show that was being broadcast to Paris. And when he walked in the studio, he was horrified to see us, because he thought he was the only person on the show. And so he just, like, was very insulting to us. I just remember I just was, like, shrinking. My hero is just like, "Who are these guys?" We were just like, "Oh, Mr. Reed, I'm sorry." But anyway, there's this, I always loved Walk in the Wild Time. But I especially loved just the beginning of it, when there's, I'm going to play just that little piece, because what I really love is that it's two basses, and one is an acoustic bass and one is an electric bass, but they slide past each other, and I think it's just a really brilliant thing. And it wasn't until years, I just always loved it, I never really analyzed it, and then I saw the bass player talking about how he recorded it. But just listen to it and think about the fact that there's two basses sliding past each other.
Hitchhiked away across USA.
little bit. I know, once you start hearing it, you can't stop. But that book is just, to me, just incredible. And I hope I explained that well enough, just having the acoustic and, you know, the nose sliding up while the other one's sliding down. Okay, what do I have here? Oh, so I guess through those connections of listening to Bowie and Lou Reed, it logically led me to the work of Brian Eno, and I think Brian Eno is just one of those great genius characters. And for me, it was really important because he treats music as an artist, and that was a really great thing for me to even know you could approach it like that. Because I always felt a little intimidated because I didn't study music. I just always had instruments around my house, and you know, I continue to make music, but I'm just like making it, like putting things together as a collage, like where you would, the way an artist would work, and that's how I work with everything I do. This is one of Eno's, his inventions was whenever he got stuck in a situation in a studio, he had all these cards that were instructions, and they would just be crazy instructions that would just be like, take the note, the wrong note, and duplicate it, and he would just have this or strange things like saying, you know, pretend you're a sailor and you're in the middle of the ocean, or just like these weird things that would help people just unblock themselves, just to kind of try something new, you know. So he would give it out to band members, and they would always, you know, just thought it was a strange way of approaching music. That's one of his early first records, which I just love the cover design. And this is that collaboration he did with Bowie, which is like my all-time favorite Bowie record. Just fantastic. This was a sleeve I designed for my band. And I don't know if any of you know my band, because it's kind of an obscure band. But a lot of the, some of our songs were sampled and sampled and sampled, and so you may recognize it, but the sample is more than the music itself. And on this record, there was a bass line that I did that was ended up being used by Grandmaster Flash in a song called White Lines, which is a lot more famous than our song. And I think there'll be a little bit of it here. I'll just play a little bit of it so you can hear the beginning bass line, and you may recognize. The competition were making jokes of it, and they used to call it Cinderella's coffin, was the guy that referred to it. Not Cinderella, it was like Snow White's coffin. So it's like a glass coffin. Yes, I'm sorry, I got that wrong. But I just love the minimalness of it. I'm a sucker for a minimal design, that's my main thing. But look at that. Oh, I just love it. This is his early sketches when he was designing it. Oh, these are some of his mottos of design. Good design is innovative. Good design makes a product useful. Good design is aesthetic. Good design makes a product understandable. Good design is unobtrusive. Good design is honest. Good design is long-lasting. Good design is thorough down to the last detail. Good design is environmentally friendly. Good design is as little design as possible. And I think Steve Jobs has a lot, he owes a lot to Dieterbach. You know, everything design, Apple designed while Steve Jobs was there is without doubt, for sure, owed to this guy. Oh, this was just something I threw in just because I thought it was just the most beautiful, one of the most beautiful objects I've ever seen. It's just, this is the kind of thing that sends me. Just love it. And it's an anonymous designer. It's just a beautiful sample. This is, these are two lamps designed by Isamu Noguchi. And he's like more known for his sculptures, but I'm a sucker for this. I have both of these lamps. I had to have them. This was something I designed. This was one of my toys that I designed. And I was on the telephone talking to somebody, and I had one of those kind of sketchbooks that has the grid lines on it. And I was just doodling and making these faces. And when I hung up the phone, I was looking at it, and I was like, oh, you know, this would make a nice toy. So I bought a piece of wood and just cut it out. And then one thing led to another, and I was able to actually produce it. And now they sell this at the MoMA's gift store. It's called Puzzle Head. This is one of my favorite artists, Klaus Oldenburg. And maybe a lot of you know him, but he's like, you know, one of those pop artists who always made huge things, like huge hamburgers and huge, like he would make sculptures, a soft version and a hard version. So you'd see like a gigantic light switch, but it'd be all like made from cloth, so it's just all like sagging. And here he is with a gigantic toothpaste walking down the street. But what I really love about his work is, his early work was really, really raw and kind of punkish. This is an example of the kind of early work he was doing. And this exhibition was called The Street, and it was just really, really raw characters, and it made a big influence on me. Like, this is one of the sculptures, it's just a woman made out of cardboard, but it's just so punky. When I was in school, this is the kind of stuff I was really, really into. And I started, like, I grew up in New Jersey, which is like right outside of New York, like 45 minutes away from New York. And I was commuting and working in galleries. And I was just really going crazy about all the graffiti that was around me. So I was kind of responding to graffiti by doing these large drawings and then pasting them in the street. So that's me at 20 years old with one of my drawings pasted up. And by doing this, I became friends with Keith Haring and Jean-Michel Basquiat, just because it was a really small scene. Like, people doing stuff on the street, you all recognized each other within a few days, and we'd just be like, you'd go to a club and you'd be bumping into these people. And so, here's Keith. I remember going on the subways with Keith, and I was like looking out for police while he did his quick drawings in the subways. Because of Basquiat painting. I remember I visited Jean-Michel in his studio when he had just finished this, and all the things I was doing with these black silhouettes, and I was just like, I think he's ripping me off. My first thought was like, you know, like when I saw this this painting in particular, I was like,
yeah.
But anyway, he was amazing, an amazing, amazing character, and obviously I don't think that now. I thought that he was ripping me off. It was just a stupid idea I had when I was like in my early 20s. But he had like at least 5 canvases going on at once. And he'd be talking to me, and just like fixing paint, and just going, doing a little something over here, and then he would continue talking, and then he would just like hit another spot over there. It was just amazing. He had books open all around him, and he was just like, he would just write down words that he would just grab from books. It was just amazing watching him work. This is just an anonymous drawing by a kid on the street. And this photographer is this woman, Helen Levitt, who is phenomenal. She used to do, she took a lot of street photography. And she had a camera in a box, and it had kind of a mirror inside. So she wouldn't be seen taking photos. She would turn like this, and she wants to shoot something this way. So the photo would bounce off, the lens would bounce off the mirror and take it. So she took a lot of photos of kids especially that are so unguarded and beautiful. Like, well, that's just another graffiti drawing that she took that I really love. This really made me laugh. It says, secret passage. Press button. Wait, yeah, press button, secret passage. But look at this beautiful photo she took of these kids dancing. It's just great that she got to capture them. This is another one of hers, which is just so fantastic. Those little floating bubbles on this little girl. Just fantastic. There's another street photographer who is a big, I'm a big, big fan of this guy, Saul Leiter. And he kind of, he did some fashion photography. He was one of the earliest photographers using color. And that was mostly like in the early, in the 50s, I would say. And he did some fashion stuff, but he was kind of unknown until the end of his life. He just was like, in his 90s, he started getting recognized. And there's a really great documentary, and you can see it online, called I'm in No Hurry. And he is fantastic. And I got the chance to meet him, and I was so thrilled when I got to meet him, because I had this idea, I was saving all the images I could find of his and putting them into a book. And then I met a friend of mine who's a photographer, who said, he was like, oh, you don't, I used to work for Saul years ago. I was his assistant. And I was like, you have to introduce me. And he was a real kind of shy hermit kind of guy. And so my friend called me up and he said, I'm with Saul. You know, come right now and I'll go out and get a cup of coffee and then I'll say I bumped into you and I'll bring you back to the apartment. So I said, okay. And so I got to the door, we opened it up and he's like, who's this guy? And he's like, no, like, didn't want me in his house. But then we ended up having an 8-hour talk after that. I sat down with him and he was just telling me so many stories, just an amazing character. And he grew up in Pittsburgh and he knew Andy Warhol when they were kids. And he was telling me stories about Andy Warhol's mother and just like crazy stuff. But I just love this photography. This particular image, I'll show it again, but first I'll show you some of his other work. Because he was a painter who turned to photography. And all his work has kind of an expressionistic quality. And all these photographs were taken in his neighborhood. He lived in the Lower East Side of Manhattan, and he never moved. He just stayed there, and just his whole career is just photos he took in that area. So this is the one I like the most, because it's shot between two boards. So you're just seeing this little strip of information. And before I even got the chance to meet Saul, I did an experiment where I hired a photographer, a friend of mine who knew Saul, and we tried to recreate this, but I wanted to do a film version of this, because I imagined that white car rolling by, and those people moving. So I made this is my first attempt just to do a little film. So I really never expected to show this publicly, it was just kind of a sketch, but I'll show it to you, but it's nothing much, it's just a sketch. And then I put some face on on top of it. So that's just a little experiment. so sorry about that. But we can play the song. We'll play the song. Let it go. It's kind of a nice way to end hearing this. But look it up online. This is called The Street, and it's by James Nair. It's really remarkable. I'm very disappointed I can't show you. I'm very sorry. And that's my end of my talk anyway, actually, so. Thank you. Kind of like the same thing with my music being always being reissued. Every 10 years, somebody reissues the music. So it's kind of like the toys are having their second life. You know? Usually when I'm making these things, I'm not really thinking of children. I'm just making these things because I want to see them. You know? Like, I used to do sculpture in school. And that puzzle definitely could have been one of my sculptures. I want to do more of everything. I want to do more animation, more products, and more music, and more books. I hope that answered.
Vamos a moderar. Vamos por aquí, Teria. ¿Vos querías preguntar? Por aquí. Y después vos.
Hi, hello.
Thanks for the talk. It's been very interesting.
I wanted to know if you use the music for your design and illustration and vice versa, how one affects the other.
Thank you. I don't know if any of you have seen, but there's a graphic novel that I did last year called Here, and I'm going to speak about it at another talk tomorrow. It's like the first really big book that I made. It's like 300 pages, and it looks like nothing else that you've seen here tonight. But while I was working on the book, I was really struggling. And it was at one point in my studio, I put all the pages up on the walls, and I suddenly thought of it as like a score, a musical score. And that really helped me kind of shape the story. Because I was like, okay, here we are here, and then we need something here, we need some little like action. So I would, you know, and then, so it was definitely composed, and that's when I realized how much the music influences other things, you know, for sure. You know. And even when I was making the films, you know instinctually when you're cutting the animation, or you just know that, okay, you know, that's the beat, and then it feels like musical that way too, because they're both. Music and film are both time-based mediums, so you know it seemed like a natural thing for me to be in the studio, like doing the sound effects on the film. Felt very much like a musical score too. So it all is one big work, you know. It all connects. You know, I used to be thinking that if there's a mistake that I tried too many different things, but it's like. They come to me really naturally, and it's just embracing it all, and it's all just one big word.
Hi. You've shown us pictures, videos, music that inspired you. Do you also have places, specific places that inspire you?
Oh, no. I've lived in New York longer than I've lived anywhere else, and that inspires me. When I go away from it, I miss it. Because of my new book, I've been traveling a lot. Like, giving this talk tomorrow, for instance, it's just great to be able to travel and see all these new places. And just coming into the city tonight, it's just so spectacular. You know, driving down and seeing all those sparkling lights down there. In every single city I go to, I go, I was in Buenos Aires last year, and I was like, this is really spectacular. And then I was, and I have fondness for other cities. Like, when I worked on the animations, I got to live in Paris, and that was pretty remarkable. And it's funny how I'm always doing the same things. Like, wherever I live, I always do a little research about that area. And I found out in Paris, the street I lived on, was just a one street, one block street, really tiny street. And then I found out that Man Ray, his studio was there, his photo studio, and the Godard film Breathless was shot on that street. And there's a famous scene where Jean-Paul Belmondo gets shot and he falls dead on the street. And so I rented the film and I'm watching it and I'm going like, here's my house. And then I was reading Patti Smith's book, and she lived in the same building that I lived in, and I was like, ah, that's so great. And then, but also on the same PhD. It just went on and on and on. It's like De Kirchhoff lived there, and Leger, and God, it just was on the list a mile long. But I'm gonna make a film kind of about that. But you know, I was just talking last night to a friend about New York, and she, it's a friend of mine. She lives in Singapore, and she just moved back to New York. And she was saying, "Oh, I miss the city so much." And we were just talking about the shapes of New York and how it all kind of is crazy, but it seems to work together. And I really felt, I feel that when I go away from New York, I feel I miss the energy of it. But I don't know. It's always a, you know, New York is also really hard. It's really expensive, and it's, you know, it's extreme. And I love escaping New York. So anytime I can get away, it's fun, and it's always fun to come back.
Hello.
Hi.
Hi.
If someone here finds you a bass guitar, would you play it?
Oh, no.
Or
no.
would you do a jig set, maybe?
Oh. I've never done that.
Well, would
I've
you
never
be
done
interested?
That. I don't know. I
okay,
have to
think
about
it.
It.
I'll talk
I'll
to
think
you
about
later.
It. Okay.
Drugs happening, and but you but it was affordable. I could get an apartment for nothing, you know? And that really was the reason all this art happened, because there was people, you know, paying so little rent, you know? The only thing I can think is comparable now is maybe Berlin, with having cheap rent to be able to have something happening. But I don't know. I think it got, in New York is not, now it's just about money. And it is insane how much things cost. And, you know, I'm lucky I have an apartment that is rent stabilized, but the apartments in my building are go for ridiculous amounts of money. And I think it's losing its character, because it's all about, like, when it's all about money, you can't have artists, and you can't have experiments, and you can't have stuff happening. So I don't know, I don't have a great hope for New York at this moment, even though I feel it's my home. Artistically, I think it's kind of, you know, all the interesting stuff is moving, being pushed out of the city. If you go deep into Brooklyn, you know, and it keeps being pushed and pushed and pushed further back, there's some interesting things happening. But when I was in New York, when I was living, I mean, in the 80s, it was the best time, because I think that there was like all these clubs, there was all this music stuff going on, all these artists popping up, and it was, everything seemed possible. And like when I was talking about Basquiat and Herring, I remember Keith Herring inviting me to a party at his house. And he was living on the Lower East Side. And he had a tiny, tiny, tiny little apartment. And at the apartment, like Madonna is there. And Madonna is nobody at this point. And she just made her first record. And they had her record on a turntable. And they took a microphone, they connected it to the turntable. And she's like singing along with her record. And then it seems ridiculous, but Andy Warhol was at this party, because it was just the point where they were, those guys were just becoming a little famous. And so and I remember I arrived at the party, I opened the door, and I went bang, and I hit somebody. And I look, and it's Warhol. And I was just like, hello, I hit Andy Warhol. And but it was so, and it was, he was such a big presence in the room that I just couldn't even look at him. He was just like, he was like this superstar, you know. But I don't think things like that could happen now. It seems that, like, I don't know, the money has been all out of whack. It's not the same city. I don't know what the new city would be, but it seemed like in the 20s, it was Paris, and then New York had its moments, and maybe, I think in the 60s and the 80s, but I don't know.
Actualmente pues estamos bombardeados de millones de imágenes, música y bueno, por internet pues encontramos millones y millones de información. Y entonces tengo dos preguntas. Él pues tiene los referentes que nos mostró de lo que le gusta son como muy clásicos. Y ahora muchos diseñadores pues actualmente acudimos como a internet como el único, la única fuente para buscar referentes, y se nos olvida muchas veces como buscar pues cosas diferentes a lo que uno ve en Pinterest o en una búsqueda rápida de Google o bueno, no sé, pues Behance, no sé. Entonces las dos preguntas son, primero, ¿qué piensa pues como de esta nueva forma de referenciarnos, pues este bombardeo, un consejo como para poder filtrar esa información o por qué es importante también pues como mirar cosas más del pasado? Y la segunda es, ¿qué cosas actuales, qué referencias actuales tiene pues ahora?
Súper bien, ahora está súper bien.
So she was saying that currently we are being bombarded constantly with information, images, music, and that designers are currently using the internet as a source for creating their a source for inspiration. So they use Pinterest or Behance, or she named a few different specific things that are on the internet that designers use as a source of inspiration, but you showed us some older things. And so her question was, why do you think it's important to look at things in the past? And then another question was, do you find any inspiration in current things? Oh yeah, and also how do you filter all of this information that bombards us every day?
Well, I definitely agree that we're being constantly bombarded with information, and it's impossible. It's impossible. I feel like I wake up and I'm so connected to my phone and my, you know, I can't live without it now. It's very strange. We're becoming cyborgs. we really are so connected with that. But I guess it's all good because, you know, when I was thinking about what I was saying about different cities, maybe it doesn't need to be a city. Maybe it's an internet kind of connection where it's just these people find each other and they don't necessarily need a real city anymore. I don't know. But, you know, like tonight, I was just showing things that influenced me, and mostly these influences are from most of them are from my childhood. I mean, towards the end there, I started showing other things, I think it's so good that we're being bombarded with all this stuff because it's the only way new stuff happens is to smash up these different ideas, you know? Everyone always, that's how anything new thing happens. It's just like, you know, you take a part of this and you take a part of this and you put them together and suddenly it's something new. So, you know, it's great. There's never been a time where we have access to all this stuff. It's just, you know, there's not, if I mention any musical thing to you, you could go home and you could just find it in a second. And I remember when I was doing music, it's like you would hunt for a record for years before you found a record. You know, and it was such a special thing. You know, now it's everything is very disposable too, which is another bad thing. But I guess this is all good. It is all like the evolution of humans, I guess. I don't know. I hope I answered your question, but it's a hard one.
Would you recommend any new or contemporary bands?
I'm trying to think about it. I feel I'm definitely out of the loop when it comes to a lot of stuff. Because I don't go out as much as I used to. And people are always sending me stuff. And but I don't know. I mean, just after Bowie passed away, I was listening to David Bowie kit, and I was just listening to everything, and I was like listening to all his interviews and stuff. And, you know, I love his new record. That's really, I think it's really a remarkable piece of work. And also, it must be even harder when you have this big thing you have to live up to all the time to create new work. But I don't know. I can't think of anybody new offhand that I'm excited about. I think we're in a lull right now when it comes to music, you know? There's nothing really, unless there's some really underground stuff that I don't know about, but it seems right now, it seems there's not much interesting things happening musically. But I may be wrong.
Good night. Thanks for you. Any Colombian artists or what do you know about us? Somebody, any
artists
of our own movement?
No,
I really don't know a lot of what's going on there. So I'm kind of interested in seeing what I can see while I'm here. I just saw like a show in New York, which was but it's another one of these old time artists, you know, and was thinking it's from Uruguay, but it's like, that's the only thing I've seen recently that I can think of. But no, I don't know what's going on there. So please, everybody send me stuff. You know, my website, send me something, you know. You know what, when we're talking about new medium and stuff, and new, like I started an Instagram site earlier this year, and that's been a great thing, because I really think it's, I just love sharing stuff all the time, and also having people doing the same for me, sending stuff back to me. It's really been great, you know, because I think it really builds like nice communities, like-minded people.
Vamos a hablar con vos y yo. Tengo rosa.
Hi. Do you have any major or formal degree? And if so, how important was that for you in your creative process?
I have, when I was in, it's funny, my father really wanted me to have a degree, and so he just said he wanted me to go to finish college. But I was halfway through, and I was like, why am I doing this? But he told me, you know, and I did it for him, just to graduate. But I was already in the middle of college. I had a band going, I was going back and forth to New York, and it didn't seem to me that it made any difference. I was gonna do all the things I was gonna do anyway. But when I was in school, I met all the people that I had formed the band with. It was through the school that I got kind of, I got access to some of the galleries where I could do an internship and be like part of the gallery, because if I went by myself, I don't know if I could have gotten that far. So it did open doors, but no one has ever asked me like for my papers to see that I graduated or anything. So it's kind of, I think it's, I don't know how to answer that. It's not, it was good because it led to just meeting people. That was an important thing. And I studied, that was the other thing was, I was gonna go to an art school, and I met this guy who was a real mentor to me. He was a guy, like I wasn't getting enough art, and I remember I took a summer class at some local college, and it was just a painting class. And the guy I met was this really fascinating guy who still is a good friend of mine, and he was an artist, but he's also made a designer, and he designed the first inflatable chair in the 60s. And he told me, don't go to art school. He said, go to a university. He said, you should meet people that are not artists. He said, you should meet people in different fields, because art does not come from art. He said, art comes from somewhere else, and then, you know. And I thought that was really good advice, because the people I met when I was like the band members, when I first met the band, they're all like the earliest people I played music with, they all have crazy careers now. Like one guy is a climate scientist, and it's just like, you're like, just like, but I think it was kind of a good advice not just to have different influences come through. So,
yeah. Hey man, thanks for this conversation after all that I came with the flights today. And I was wondering, you know, I can picture you as a mad scientist in your studio, working with different arts and mixing out different arts. So I have a question, actually, because tomorrow we will be talking about comics and drawing.
Right.
How the hell did you get involved with comics, this lowbrow art form?
Okay. Well, my older brothers were really into like superhero comics, but when I was a kid, I'm trying to remember the first thing I bought comic was like Crazy Cat, and then right after Crazy Cat, I saw Crumb, so it's like a big jump, but Crumb was like a huge influence, just to see something just so wild as that. And then I remember seeing Spiegelman's Royal Magazine, and I was just, you know, doing my music and stuff, and I went into a shop, and there it was, and it was like big format, and it was just so old, and I was like, what is this? It seemed like the newest, greatest thing. So then I bought some of them, and then I went to see Spiegelman to talk, and that's how I started. I just saw Kochi, he gave a talk about the history of comics, and I was like, wow, I'm gonna try something. And I had this idea, I did it, sent it to him, and that's how I got my first thing published. It was just that simple. And I think I have a lot of respect for comics, because there's things you can do in comics that you can't do with any other medium. And I think it's just, I don't feel exclusively like I am just a cartoonist. I just can't, I'm too restless. I can't put all my energy into one thing. But, I'm good friends with a lot of cartoonists who I respect a lot. Like Chris Ware, I could never do what Chris Ware does. He's like genius, you know. I love doing it sometimes. I mean, the latest book is an example.
Well, I'm going to ask you the last two questions. The first one is, you talk about you love sharing and you love art, and your inspiration comes from a lot of people. What's your opinion about copyright and patent and that kind of things? And my second is, we can share your presentation.
Oh, yeah. Oh, setting me up. It's funny, because when the music was ripped off, we were already big fans of Grandmaster Flash. We had all these records and stuff. And then when somebody told me, they said, have you heard this new Grandmaster Flash song? He's using your bass line. And I was kind of proud at first. I was like, oh, that's, but then it started sinking about the money after. And then I'm like, oh, And then it turned into a big nightmare of like lawsuits. And it was just like it took years to finally settle. But we finally now we make money every time it gets played. But I don't have any, I think that when I was talking before about the only way something new happens is you take a little bit of this, a little bit of this, and put it together. It's like, that's been going on forever. That's just the way things are. So I don't have any resentment of, it's just always people are ripping each other off to build new things. It's just the way it works. It's like the animal kingdom, So I have nothing against anybody doing that. It's just, and of course you can use the recorded thing.
Muchas gracias a Richard, muchas gracias a todos ustedes por la compañía esta noche en esta conversación. Un aviso antes del cierre formal de Andrés, mañana a las 4:30 de la tarde, en el Parque Biblioteca Belén, año 76, hay una conversación nuevamente con él acerca de su último libro, del cual hablaba hace un momento, de Here o Aquí, que mañana creo que se podrá conseguir, nos ha informado en su editorial. Y será una conversación de aproximadamente una hora acerca de su trabajo como dibujante en los cómics. Realmente Here o Aquí, que es la traducción al español, es un cómic que es de los más influyentes en los últimos 30 años, no solamente para el cómic, sino para nuestras artes, por lo que puede lograr a nivel de lo exclusivo que puede lograr el lenguaje del cómic. Entonces, mañana la entrada es libre. Mañana, para aquellos que pronto tuvieron la dificultad pues, con el idioma inglés, hay traducción simultánea. Y nuevamente agradecer a David Quijero, a Calle 9+1, al Hate Festival, que celebra su cuarto año aquí en Medellín, a El Fire y a Premios. Y nuevamente, muchas gracias a Richard.
Para cerrar, como siempre, invitarlo mañana, el jueves, lo dejo porque quiero, es el lanzamiento de la revista Sandía. Vienen Daniel Bustamante, Santiago Muñoz, Alejandro Montoya y Alejandro Cortés. Están todos invitados. Si alguien no le llegó alguno de los tarritos, están por acá al lado del computador. Y que disfruten la noche, que hoy hay salsa con Jamming en vivo. Muchas gracias y disfrútenme.